Welcome to the Master's Child Church, where we are obtaining souls through the Word and retaining souls through love. This is Sunday Morning Manna. If you are a first-time visitor to our page, please type first time in the comments. If you are tuning in from another country or other parts of the world, type in to let us know where you're viewing from. Please feel free to share today's broadcast with as many people as you know. Also, feel free to comment if you get encouraged, blessed, or stirred up as you hear the Word of God. And use the emojis at any time to get our online activity to be heard throughout our time. Thank you for joining our cyber sanctuary. Now let's prepare our hearts for worship.
Good morning, Master Child. Another day, another opportunity to bless the name of our God, for He is still worthy, He's strong, and He's mighty. And it ought to be in our heart that we're going to chase after Him, chase after His presence. God, we need You more. We need You. Hallelujah. Woo! We need You, Lord. I'm chasing after You, no matter what I have to do, 'cause I need You more and more. I'm chasing after You, no matter what I have to do, 'cause I need You more and more. Come on, quiet, help me say it.
I'm chasing after You,
no matter chasing after You, no matter what, 'cause I need You. Come on, if that's your prayer, why don't you wave your hands? I'm chasing after You, Lord, no matter what, 'cause I need You. After You, I'm praising my way through, just to be closer to You. Oh, that's my prayer. I'm chasing after You. Is that I want to be closer to You, Lord. Yeah. Oh, I'm chasing after You. Woo. I'm praising my way through. 'Cause I gotta be, I want to be close. Oh, closer than yesterday, God. That's why. Woo. You want to tell them like You mean it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm praising my way through. Woo. 'Cause I want to be close to You, Jesus. Whoa. God.
situation, God.
This month, our November theme, Still Thankful, 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Tribe of Judah Virtual Fellowship, Thursday, November 19th, 2020 at 7:30 p.m. RSVP, mcctribeofjudah30@gmail.com to receive Zoom credentials. For additional information, please contact Pastor Vera Williams. Seasoned Saints, Salt of the Earth Virtual Fellowship, Sunday, November 22nd at 1:30 p.m., facilitated by Pastor Virginia Smith. The Zoom meeting link is below. The meeting ID, 409-222-5256. If you're 55 and older, please contact Tony Smith, Cynthia Douglas, or call the church office for more information. We want to thank you for joining us. Now let's get ready to receive today's message with Bishop Melvin Robinson Jr., your senior pastor of the Master's Child Church.
Well, I thank God for his power. I thank him for his mercy, his grace. And this is why we need him more and more. This is why we're chasing after him. This is why we desire him. It's because everything we need, he has it. And we thank God for the zeal that we continue to have because of our pursuit to acquire what it is that he has. And not only that, we're trying to acquire his presence. We're really trying to acquire his holiness, his character, his integrity, so we can reflect who he is as our God. And so I'm thankful. And I hope that I'm in the cyber sanctuary with those who are as thankful as I am when it comes to the pursuit of our God and acquiring what's necessary so we can reflect who he is. He is an absolute, awesome God, and he's worthy to be praised. Thank God for our praise team, our minister of music. Thank God for our first lady. We thank God for our co-founder and all of our associate pastors and our ministerial team. Thank God for the leadership of MCC, the laity of MCC. We're just one big family. Thank God for every last one of you. I need my emoji ministry to get ready, because we're getting ready to show some love to our first-time visitors. Everyone who is visiting with us for the first time, I pray that you would note that in the comment box. Let us know that you're here for the first time. We want to show you some love and thank God for your presence with us on this morning. This is imperative to us because it's so many churches that are streaming live at this time, but you stopped by to be with us on this morning, and we're grateful for you being with us. And so those hearts that love, all that is for you. And to those who visit with us regularly, we count you as honorary family, and we absolutely pray blessings upon you as well. And so we're grateful for everyone who was a part of the Cyber Sanctuary on this morning. This morning is a beautiful, beautiful day that the Lord has given us. He's woke us up this morning. He has woken us up this morning and started us on our way. We didn't have to see this day, but he allowed us to see this day. And because he has done that, we want to just tell him thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for everything that you have done. I pray that you are here with me and you possess thankful hearts as well. Well, it's offering time in the sanctuary. Let's give unto God that which belongs to him. Let's give him the tithe, the offering, every seed that you're going to sow. Let's give that to him. Let's go ahead and make sure that we honor him in our giving. And I want to thank God for every member of the Master's Child Church and those who are not members who sow into this ministry faithfully. Thank you. Thank you. And consistently, and have been doing so throughout this pandemic. Thank you so much. And those who have not been able to sow, God knows your heart. God knows your heart. And we're just praying that things will be better, that not only you can sow in the house of the Lord, but that all your needs will be met, because he said he will, that's right, supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory. So we're praying that God would provide what you need in this season. And even though it may be a little struggle economically, God is going to come through. He's going to get you through it. And so just know that you're in my prayers. But I tell you, it has been just a phenomenal observation of how those who are able to give have been giving consistently throughout this pandemic. And as you probably see now, we are still moving forward with the vision as it relates to our construction of the cathedral and affordable living and all the things that God has given us a vision for right there at 6485 Indian Head Highway. God is doing some miraculous things. And I am so, 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 so excited about where we are, MCC, as relates to the progression of the vision that God has tasked us with. And so I am so elated. I'm very glad. I'm excited. I tell you, things are looking real good for MCC, and we owe him all the glory for it. So we want you to know that your giving has also assisted others in their time of need. We don't broadcast it. We don't post it. That's not something that I'm led to do. But just know that we have been able to assist many throughout this pandemic in a confidential way because of your giving. So thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you again for your giving. Let me pray. Father, I thank you so much for what it is that you have provided us. And we know what we owe you. In fact, we owe you everything. But in the spirit of obedience, we know what your word has commanded us to give back to you, the tithe, the offering, and even the seeds that we sow to fund and to finance all the components and dynamics of the vision that you have given for this ministry. And so, God, as we give by faith, knowing that what we give will be much smaller than what we receive in return. And we thank you for it. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. All right. All right. Well, get your word. Get your word. whether you will be viewing the Word electronically or traditionally through a paper Bible, however you are going to observe the Word, please prepare for the Word of God. Is getting ready to come into your hearing right now. And there's someone who's listening to me. You need a word. You need a word from God. You've been through a whole lot, and you're not in the cyber sanctuary for nothing. You need to hear from God concerning what it is that he want you to be assured of when it comes to his presence being with you and his word and how it will come through for you. And so I want you to grab that word. We are still dealing with our theme, still thankful, 1 Thessalonians 5:18. Whatever happens, keep thanking God because of Jesus, because this is what God wants you to do. And so we're going to stay in that vein. And we are going to approach that theme in a way that really, really warrants your attention. I really want you to give me your undivided attention just for a few minutes. And I want to encourage your hearts as it relates to what God put on my heart to convey to you. All right, go to Psalms chapter 34. Very, very familiar passage of scripture. And I'm just going to read the 19th verse, just one verse. That's all I need. And it says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. I should be able to do the benediction and read the names of those who are on our prayer list and close out. That's a word all by itself. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord himself delivers him out of them all. I want to really key in on that many. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. You got to get through that many. If you're dealing with that many, that is challenging. Many represents a lot. It's a lot that the righteous goes through. It says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. And before that deliverance comes, that many can challenge the best of us. And it can cause us to say, this is too much. This is too much. That's what I want to deal with on this morning. I want to deal with those who have come to the conclusion that your many, I don't know about nobody else's many, but I want to deal with your many. Have you ever have come to the conclusion that so much have come your way that you have found yourself saying, this is too much. It's too much. Let's deal with that this morning. Let's deal with it. Father, I thank you so much for the word that you have put in my heart. Thank you for the revelation, the interpretation that you have given me. Because I can't preach without it. I can't teach without it. I can't do anything without it. In fact, I can't live without it. I can't survive without it. I can't thrive. I can't face my challenges without it. And so I give you the glory for your word. And so as I minister this morning, help me. Allow the Holy Spirit to bring back to my remembrance all that you would want me to say to your wonderful people. This is my prayer In Jesus' name, amen. I want to start off by sharing with you something that I saw, I witnessed on CNN. It was intriguing. It caught my attention. Mayor Khan, who is the mayor of London, England, he was being interviewed, and I can't remember who interviewed him, but he was being interviewed, and this was after President-elect Biden was projected to win the presidency of the United States. And the mayor, throughout the 4 years of the outgoing president's term, has experienced a whole lot of attacks from him. That it's been so contentious. And when when they interviewed him, and the one who was doing the interview, he knew how contentious the friction was between the mayor and the president that's getting ready to leave in a few weeks. When the camera went live on him, he was smiling. He was just smiling. And the one who was doing the interview said, "Wow, I wonder what that smile is about." He says, she said, I see a smile. And this is what he said, and I quote, he says, "You see a smile, or this is a smile on a tired face." Unquote. Let me quote that again. He said, "This is a smile on a tired face," unquote. In other words, what he was saying, yeah, I'm smiling, but I'm tired. I'm tired. This situation with this president has worn me out. It has literally drained me. And though I'm smiling that things are getting ready to change, this smile is on a tired face. I wonder if I have some tired faces in the cyber sanctuary. And you said, "Well, Pastor, I know what the theme is. I know what you're telling me to do. You're telling me to remain thankful, that I should be still thankful. But this year has worn me out. And I may be able to express some type of thankfulness, but I want you to know I'm tired. I'm thankful, but I'm tired. I'm grateful, but I'm tired. Because this year has worn me out. And I know we're getting ready to exit this year. I know that, and I know I've survived it. I know I'm still here. I get it, and I thank you for the encouragement, and I'm in the cyber sanctuary. I ain't going nowhere, but I have to be honest with you. Even if you see me smiling, that smile is on a tired face. I'm tired. Every 5 minutes, it's something. It's something. And as soon as I get over that, it's something else. And if I get over that, it's something else. I'm tired of going through challenge after challenge after challenge. I'm tired of seeing people leaving. I'm tired. I'm tired. I'm worn out of trying to rebound from emotional setbacks and financial setbacks and personal setbacks and health setbacks. And if it's not me, it's somebody close to me And I have to admit, I'm in the cyber sanctuary, but I'm tired. I'm tired. And I want you to understand that this is really where I believe everybody needs to be from a transparent perspective. And so you can bring about some understanding as to why this seemingly onslaught of just problems and issues and loss and, I mean, everything that we have dealt with throughout this year has come upon us. And for some of us, we have a smile, but I promise you, it's on a tired face, because I'm tired of it. I'm tired of the agony, the pain, the loss. I'm tired of the sicknesses, the illnesses. I'm just tired of it. I'm just tired of the setbacks. Not going to quit, but I'm just tired. And I want you to know what this is about. I want you to see that when it comes to what it is that we are dealing with, in that realm, and from that perspective, it's because of who we are. Honestly, it's because of who we are, and from a theological perspective, because when I tell you the enemy has always desired to bring everything he possibly can bring against us because he knows that his time is short. Yeah, he knows that his time is short. And what he's trying to do, he's trying to literally, I mean, in the book of Revelations, when Satan was kicked out of heaven, the Bible talks about when he was descending into the earth realm, John, the Revelator, says in his writings, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth, because Daniel said that it's Satan, the Antichrist, his desire is to wear the saints out. That's really his desire. To wear us out. And even when you read the story about Job, it was when God gathered with the sons of God, Satan gathered too. He gathered too. I promise you, he gathered too. And he was right in the midst. God looks up and see him in the meeting and say, what are you doing? Where have you been? He said, listen, I'm going to and fro. I'm going up and down. I'm going everywhere. I'm seeking to see who I can devour. I'm seeking who I can wear out. I mean, I'm trying to wear them out simply because who they are relationally to you. If it's not them, I'm going after their family. If it's not their family, I'm going after their finances. If it's not their finances, I'm going after their health. I'm going after their mind. I'm trying to devour all that who they are when it comes to who they are because of their commitment and loyalty to you. And God says, did you ever consider my servant Job? He said, I did, but you got a hedge. You got a hedge around him. I tried to get to him, but that hedge was too strong. I couldn't penetrate that hedge. But I promise you, if you move the hedge, if you move that hedge, I'm telling you, the Job that you think he is with the hedge will become another version of himself. That's the only reason he's serving you, because you're protecting him and you're prospering him. He said, that's fine. That's fine. I'm going to remove that. I remove the hedge. Because I'm so confident that even though you may make him tired, even though you may wear him out, even though you may attack him, his loyalty and his integrity will remain intact. He attacked his family, that devil attacked his family, burnt up his possessions. I mean, it wasn't enough for him to get the family. It wasn't enough for him to get the possessions. I mean, he wore Job out. And Job said, though he slept, I'm tired now. Tired of this fella. But though he slay me, yet will I trust them. Satan goes back to God and say, listen, I ain't finished. I'm going to keep going. Oh, no, I'm not. I'm going to keep wearing them out. It'll wear on him. Give me another shot at it. He said, okay, that's fine. Okay, you can have everything he has, but you better not take his life. Don't take his life. You can't take his life. And that's what he did. I mean, it was enough for him to attack family, his possessions. Now he has attacked his health, and Job has been reduced to skin and bone. And his wife speaks up and said, this is too much. No. This is too much. This is too much. Go ahead and just curse your God and die. And Job said, listen, I'm tired. I am tired. And this is a lot. But you sound like a foolish woman. How am I going to curse the one that I need to get me out of this affliction that I'm in? And he said, no, naked I came here. Naked I'm going to leave. But blessed be. Blessed be the name of the Lord. This is what Satan does. This is what he got. This is how he rolls. He's not satisfied that he attacked you here. He wants to attack you there and over here. He doesn't stop. He is relentless. From Genesis to Revelations to where we are right now, Satan has always, he brings it. When Satan brings it, he brings it. He brings it. And somebody knows what I'm talking about because at this point, you have come to the conclusion that this is too much. The prophet Isaiah looked at it and said, when the enemy comes in like a flood, oh, he will flood your life with affliction. He will flood your life with problems. I mean, when he comes, he flood you with the things that he's trying to use to prove to God that you are not who you are, you know, because he can't stand the relationship that you have with him, because he cannot have that relationship any longer. And he knows his time is short. He don't have a lot of time. So Isaiah warns and said, when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard. And I want you to remember that word. I want you to remember that word. He will lift up a standard against him. And so we understand how God responds to the onslaught of the enemy when he floods you with things that he uses to wear you out. There's a standard that the Spirit of the Lord lifts up against him. Now, I'm going to park that because I want to utilize something else when it comes to the prophet Isaiah, giving us some insight about this relentless agenda of the enemy to wear us out. I mean, excessively, because it was Isaiah said, now, you have to understand that, first of all, you're not in this alone. God is with you. God is with you. And whenever you feel yourself depleted of what you need to get through, just remember it's God that gives power to the weak. He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases their strength. Young men will faint. The young will faint and be weary. Not only that, but young men, they're going to fall. That's going to happen. That's going to happen. But they that wait on the Lord, not they that waver, not they that vacillate in and out of who they are with God because they've been worn out by the enemy, but they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. I don't have nobody here. They shall mount up with wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They will walk and not faint. I need you to hear this because that's what's going on when the enemy is trying to wear us out and drain us. We get to the point where we don't even have strength to fight back, strength to go on. But the prophet is telling us that when you have a moment like that, just wait. Wait until he brings you out. Wait until he turns it around. Wait until he fixes the issue. Wait until he heals you. Wait until he provides what it is that you need in order for you to be economically sufficient. Wait on his reason as to why he didn't turn things around. Just wait. Wait. Don't waver, because that's the trick of the enemy. He doesn't want you to wait. He wants you to waver. And the prophet says, when you get that strength, it's going to be some days you're going to feel like you can fly. But when that fly turns into a run, he says, run, but don't be weary. You see, he said, now when that run turns into a walk, he says, walk, but don't faint. He said, so your pace may change, but don't you change. It doesn't matter if you feel like flying some days, running some days, walking some days, keep on moving. And this is what I want to encourage you. I'm ready to shut it down, but I feel the Holy Spirit really impacting somebody's mindset right now. There's gonna be some days you're gonna feel like flying, but when you don't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. But the strength that God is going to give you, he said, I'm going to teach you how to run and not be weary. I'm going to give you strength to be able to walk and not faint. And so that weariness that comes against you is trying to stop your movement. And so you got to learn how to walk and chew bubble gum at the same time. And that's why you're in the sanctuary. Because listen, I may be down to a walk, but I will not faint. I may be down to a run, but I will not be weary. I have to learn how to smile even when I'm tired. I have to learn how to give him praise even when I'm worn out. I have to learn how to honor him and give him what it is that he needs from me. Because that is my expression. That's the indication that the enemy will not stop my movement. And that's why the prophet warns us by saying, listen, wait, don't waver. Wait, don't waver. I need somebody to help me to spread that. Wait, don't waver. And while you're waiting, God is renewing your strength. Because God doesn't give strength so you can waver. He gives you strength so you can wait on him. He's coming. Oh, he's going to come through. He's going to come through because he's going to give you the strength to wait on him. I don't know how long it's going to take. I don't. But he's coming. He's going to come through. And I want you to know that everything that the enemy is bringing against you, it's because of who you are and the movement he see active in your life as a child of God. when you deal with the book of Psalms, let me get into the text. When you see the book of Psalms, the first two chapters is what you call an introduction. That's just the introduction. But when you look at chapters 3 through 41, those chapters, I believe 39 chapters, are centered around David's conflict with Saul. One man, Saul. And see, what you have to understand, all of what you're going through is coming through one person. It's coming from one person. Who it comes through, that may vary, but it's just one person. It's the Antichrist. It's the devil. It's Satan himself bringing about what it is that he is trying to cause you to feel worn out in your stride in Christ. Can you imagine 39 chapters centers around David's conflict with Saul? That's a lot of conflict. That's a lot. 39 chapters. Those chapters are linked to David's conflict with Saul. You see? And see, you have to understand, it deals with this righteousness that's associated with David, and how David's argument is that, wow, how is it that the righteous goes through all of this? How is it that you can be righteous and be right with God and experience so much conflict, especially when it's coming from one person? And so we have to deal with righteousness. Righteousness really speaks to holiness and upright living according to the standards of God. This word comes from a root word which means straightness. And it's when you're in a state that conforms with an authoritative standard. Therefore, you have to understand that righteousness really deals with morality. It deals with morality. And God is the very definition and source of all righteousness. So when we talk about man's righteousness, we're defining it as God's standards. So whenever I talk about my righteousness, it's not really my righteousness, it's my ability to use the Holy Spirit to be able to mirror the standards of God. And you have to understand that even when you are mirroring the standards of God, you are imperfectly righteous, because you don't get it right all the time. But that's why God says, I don't search the outer. That's how David became king. He didn't search the outer. No, he doesn't look at the outer. He looks at the heart, the righteousness that is embedded in your heart. And that righteousness is a goal. It's a goal. That's what you're striving for. That's what you're going after. That's what you're chasing. So you can mirror more about who God is from a character perspective and his integrity. It's about morality. It's about morality. And here is David in a place of righteousness, as I just explained it. But 39 chapters are centered around David's conflict with Saul. Saul is done. Saul is done, because everything that led up to God rejecting him was because of unrighteousness. In fact, he was chosen by people, right? God rejects him and he elects David. And so it's like David is the president-elect of Israel. I wish I had somebody. He's the president-elect of Israel. He's not in the castle. He's not in the White House. He's not in yet, okay? And because David has been elected and Saul has been rejected, here is Saul causing conflict because of being elected, because David has been elected by God, he is throwing assaults. He's threatening David's life. He's coming. I mean, he's relentless. He just won't stop. 39 chapters. David is dealing with conflict regarding Saul. And so it makes you ask, my goodness, I mean, didn't know you would have to go through this much conflict because you are anointed. Didn't know this much conflict was associated with being elected by God. Just didn't know. You got to understand, when you stand in the righteous place of God, when God has selected you and elected you to be who you are, you will go through conflict, and it's coming from one person. And it's the person that don't want you, don't want to see you strive and move progressively in the things that God has called you to do. And this conflict with Saul, I mean, it continued. And what happens is Saul, in his jealousy, he pursues David. And when he pursues David, he threatens David's life. Now, this is the loneliest, this is the most loneliest time in David's life. He's never been lonely than he is right now. And he goes to the Philistines. And when the Philistines figure out who he is, remember all this about who you are in God, the Bible said that David had to act like he was crazy. He had to act like he was crazy to protect himself. He had to be something other than what he was in order to protect himself. And Abimelech drove him out, and David departed. Because being who you're not sometimes is your protection. In fact, from a human standpoint, I know we're saved and I know that we're sanctified, but please understand, if we operate in our natural, there's still some crazy. I don't have people in here. I don't have real people. There's still some crazy way down up in that area, that fleshly area. And the problem is we know how to suppress it. We know how to refrain from causing ourselves to have to go there. But David said, I had to pretend like I was crazy to protect myself. Just to protect myself. You see? So understand that all of that is in our flesh. All of it is in our flesh, because we sometimes, when people are threatened by who you are, they just can't take it. They just can't take who you are. Sometimes you have to be who you're not to protect yourself from their reaction, mainly because of envy and jealousy to who you are, because they know you're coming. I wish I had somebody here. Saul was jealous because David was next. And I want to ask people who's in this sanctuary, don't you know that the enemy knows that you're next? You are next in line for a miracle, next in line for an elevation, next in line for what it is that God has already revealed to you, that you've been dreaming about, that you've been praying about, that you've been seeking him about. You are next, and the devil can't stand it. And sometimes when people are threatened by who God is calling you to be, you have to be something else to protect yourself from behavior that wears you out, from behavior that drains you. And that's what David did. David said, I got to play crazy. I got to play like I'm crazy, because the only thing that's gonna get me out of this situation, these people got to know I know how to be crazy. And I was trying to act like I was called. I was trying to walk in my calling. Now I have to I have to appear to you that I'm a little crazy, because crazy is the only thing sometimes that will protect me from a natural perspective. David was not proud of that. David knew that he altered who he was, and he knew that the enemy had gotten to him, because now the enemy has him operating in an identity that contradicts who he really are. He's a king. He's the president-elect of Israel. He's ready going to the castle. He's ready going to the White House. He's not there yet. And the reason why he can't get in, he can't get access, is because the outgoing president, I wish I had five people, is causing conflict because of jealousy. You see? But if God selects you, I don't care what the enemy does. Whatever he has selected you for, it shall come to pass. And David said, I dropped the ball on that, because the enemy I'm thinking that I should be able to, it should be a peaceful transfer of power here. It should be a peaceful transfer of power, but all I'm getting is a lot of conflict. And even the people that I went to for help, when they found out who I was, they began to threaten me, and I had to protect myself. I had to come out of character to protect myself. Do I have somebody in here that can be real with me? Listen, have you ever found yourself, you're not proud of it, but have you ever found yourself coming out of character because you feel like sometimes that's what you have to do to protect yourself? To let people know, listen, I'm not the one now. I'm not the one. I love the Lord, and I'm saved, sanctified. But I'm telling you now, I know how to pull something out to make you understand. I know how to protect myself now. I know going down the hall now, going, because if I have to protect myself, I know how to pull out something. I know how to do that. I'm not going to be proud of it, but I'll do that. And this is what I want to caution you about. This is the caveat to all this. Be careful. Because when the enemy does not want you to reflect the righteousness, the standard, the character of God, he will flood you with conflict, flood you with stress, and flood you with things that will cause you to act out of character. And I need people in the cyber sanctuary before I close it, though, that you're not proud of it, but there's been moments that you've been so stressed and said that this too much, that certain things have brought you out of character. And this is where David is. He has come out of character, but they left him alone. Yeah, he has come out of character, but he survived. He's not proud of it, but the Philistines left him alone. Yeah, because he showed him crazy. He was trying to show them his calling, but he showed them crazy. He said, oh, you got to go on. We, that's all right. Go on. We're going to let you go, because we don't know what's going on with you. He said, that's all right. I'm not proud of it, but I got out of the life. When he leaves the Philistines, he finds himself in a cave. Lord help me. He finds himself in a cave. He's in a cave at Adullam, and the Bible says that there were some desperate men that joined him. He was so lonely, but in the cave there were some desperate men that joined him in the cave. And based on the purpose of the writing of this particular Psalm 34, the theologian said it was in that cave that he wrote this particular song. He wrote this particular song, and then he sung the psalm to the men that had joined him. Oh, that's a whole lot to unpack, but I got to let you go. I got to let you go, because I feel something pushing through here. This is the thing. He's on his way to the castle. He's not there, because the one in the castle right now, he's showing a whole lot of pettiness. He's threatening his life. He's providing a lot of conflict, and David is tired. He is worn out. And he finds himself in a cave. And see, listen, when you worn out like that, you're not thinking about no castle, no car, no title. You don't care where you are. You just want to find somewhere where you can rest from being attacked. You want to rest from pettiness, conflict. You want to rest from people being jealous and envious over stuff that you didn't even want. It was God that selected David. It wasn't that he selected himself. He just found the cave. He just found a cave because he just wanted some peace. It hid him from Saul. It hid him from the attack, but he wanted to find a cave. He's in a cave and desperate men join him. Let me break this down for you real quickly. Hear me good. Don't have a lot of confidence in people who only can join you when you are in the castle. I wish I had somebody. There's a lot of people who will join you and be there for you when you get to your castle. But you better remember the people that when you were lonely, worn out, felt like you couldn't make it, too much was going on. Remember the people who joined you while you were in the cave. I wish I had five people who know that you yourself know what it is to run and find yourself in the cave of life. And not too many people will come in the cave. They'll come in the castle. They'll get with you when you get to position. They'll get with you when you get to where you're going. But not too many people will join you while you're in the cave. And I want to thank God that he sent some people to me while I was in the cave. It wasn't the cream of the crop. It wasn't who I thought would be there. But at this point, I'm just glad I got people who know that when I need them, when I'm in my cave, they will come around. They're not jealous of me. They're not envious of me. They're not trying to attack me. They're trying to be there and connect with me to help me to get through my cave season. And I want to thank God. Wish I had somebody here. For those who survived your cave, and perhaps you're in a cave right now. You're on your way to the castle. You're on your way to where God wants you to be, but you're in a cave right now. You're in a cave right now. The phone calls get slim when you're in a cave. The text messages get slim when you're in the cave. When you're in a cave, don't look like people are concerned. They don't reach out to you. They're not there. There's not a whole lot going on with people when you're in the cave. But God will send, when you are at your lowest point, God will send some people to be with you in the cave. And it was in that cave that he wrote Psalms 34. And he said, now, I want you to know, those who are living a righteous life. I don't have nobody here. Those of you who are living a righteous life, please understand that you're going to go through your many. I don't have six people. And he's talking to these men who are desperate. I don't know about you, but I'm desperate for relief. I'm desperate for a breakthrough. I'm desperate for understanding. I'm desperate for him to open up a door. I'm desperate for him to mend my heart. I'm desperate for the prosperity and the favor of God. At this point, I'm desperate. Give me what you got today, Bishop. You can preach as long as you need to preach. You can reveal as much as you need to reveal. I'm desperate this morning. You don't have to rush. I'm in a cave. I ain't got nowhere to go. I'm in a cave. I have some things going on in my family. I have some things going on in my personal life. I have some things going on internally. I am desperate. That's why I'm sitting here looking at a computer, listening to you speak, because I'm desperate for God to come through, mightily on my behalf. And here I am getting ready to tell you what you need, because you're going to survive your minute. I don't have nobody here. I know it's a lot. I know it's a lot going on, but you're going to get through this. Yeah, I know you're in a cave right now, but there's a castle waiting for you. The only reason why you're going through the cave is because you got to get through the cave to get through the castle. There's an anointing on your life. God, there's a mantle on your life. That righteousness is really the thing that the enemy is concerned about, because he's trying to bring you out of character so he can belittle who you are from a spiritual perspective before the observation of God. But God says you have grace for that. Don't worry about that. Don't worry about that. Sit right where you are and wait for me. I wish I had somebody here. Wait right wherever you are, wait for me, because they that wait on the Lord, they that wait on the Lord, not waver, but they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. Yeah, that's what Isaiah told us, and that's what I want you to see, because here is the enemy has come in as a flood and has chased and have caused David to end up in a cave. But here he is with desperate men, desperate to hear something, desperate to hear some direction, some guidance, and he comes with the standard. I don't have nobody here. He comes with the standard. He says, this is a standard that you're going to have to lift up against the enemy. This is a standard that you're going to have to lift up against the enemy when he comes in like a flood. He says, many are the afflictions. I don't have nobody here. Of the righteous. That's how you know you're righteous, when you go through your many. When you go through your many, it's testing. It's testing how concrete your righteousness is before the observation of God. And so when the enemy comes in and he provides many afflictions upon your life, what you have to understand is that you have to, with all that you have, say, the enemy, you're not going to allow me to go crazy. You're not going to allow me or make me lose my faith in God. You're not going to allow me to diminish and walk away from a righteous position that I have with God, because I'm going through many of them. I mean, many of them, many of the afflictions of the righteous. But this is what David learned, and he's speaking to desperate people, because what he's saying is, I know you're dealing with desperation, but I got a revelation for your desperation. And I wish I had some people in here who know I'm going through desperation, but I'm sitting in front of this computer because I need some revelation. And so here it comes. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. This is a standard that you have to live by. But the Lord, I don't have five people. I don't have five people. I'm going to put my book up. But the Lord shall deliver him out of them all. Let me close with this. I know some of you are going through a whole lot. I know you're facing a whole lot. And I know you're going through your many. But your many cannot defeat mighty. I don't have nobody here. Your many cannot defeat mighty. Because when mighty shows up, many has to loose you. Many has to free you. Because when mighty shows up in the person of God, because he said, it's nothing that you in, no affliction that has surrounded you, no affliction that you find yourself in, there's not one that I can't get you out of. And so today is a day of deliverance from your many. From your many, because mighty knows how to get the victory over many. So it doesn't matter what your many is, when mighty shows up, many cannot defeat mighty. And God says, I'm mighty in your situation. And when I show up, when I make up my mind, when your wait is over, I want you to know that you are coming out of what your many is trying to keep you in, because many, God said, I would not allow many to keep you in bondage. I would not allow many to keep you isolated from what it is that I have from your life. So when many come, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord himself said, I'm going to deliver you out of every last one of them. There's not an affliction that you have that God cannot deliver you out of. And so this is my word to you. I know as much, but it's not too much that God can get you out of. And I need you to hold on. I need you to keep the faith. I need you to believe God. I need you to walk in that standard. I need you to hold on to your righteousness. I need you to wait on God. I don't want you to be weary. I don't want you to faint. I don't want you to give up, because I believe your wait is over. Mighty has shown up. Mighty has shown up. And when mighty shows up, many cannot hold you in the state that you're in. I want to preach until you feel free. I want to preach until you feel delivered. Deliverance is yours. Deliverance is something that God provides his people when he knows we can't get out of things that the enemy is trying to get us in. David wrote this text. He wrote this chapter while he was in the cave. He wrote it in a cave and had the nerve to sing it to those who were desperate. I can't sing it, but I can preach it. I can preach it. I want to keep saying many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord himself shall deliver him, deliver you, deliver me out of them all. And I want to decree and declare, you coming out. You coming out. There are some things that you can't control, and you have to give that to God, but you don't have to stay in it. You're coming out of it. It's too much affliction. It's too much pain. It's too much turmoil. It's too much conflict. You coming out of that, because God's deliverance is showing up on your behalf, and you have to decree and declare, God's going to get me out of this. Oh, now God's going to turn this around. This is not a permanent situation. The God that I serve, he is mightier than my many. And I want you to know that when God shows up on your behalf, he shows up to let you know that when it comes to living a righteous life, it doesn't exclude you from affliction. But the one thing that you can remember, you are not in this by yourself, because God says, if I can allow you to go in it, then I can allow you to come out of it. And those of you who are tired, those of you who are in a cave right now, those of you that feel like you're lonely and nobody is there to help you through, God told me to tell you this morning, he knows how much you can bear. And though it may be too much for you, it's not too much for him. Because your many cannot defeat his might. Your many cannot defeat mighty. And our God is mighty. Our God is powerful. Our God is undefeated. And it's nothing that you're in that he cannot deliver you out of. So many are the afflictions of the righteous. But your Lord, my God, shall deliver us out of them all. And I want you to start thanking him right now for your deliverance. Start praising him right now for your deliverance. Because it's, you know, what you're dealing with right now, it's nothing. It's nothing. It's nothing. It's nothing compared to the might of God. And the thing is, as I close, the thing is that when you begin to allow the standard of God's word to be a weapon against the flood of the enemy, he cannot move you out of a place of righteousness. And if you can say today, if you can say today, out of all the things I've been through, I'm tired, I'm worn, I'm perplexed, drained. I got to be honest about that. But I'm still thankful. I'm still grateful. Because everything that I've gone through, and even what I'm going through right now, the standard of God's word will prevail on my behalf. Some of you listening to me right now, you can really relate to what I've been speaking about since I've been ministering. and you're in a place where you feel like, God, I'm smiling, but I'm tired. I'm going through. I've been in this cave. I thank God for those who helped me through. And I thank God for the revelation that God has given me for my desperation. I thank God for that. But I heard a word today. I heard a word that some days I'm going to be flying, some days I'm going to run, some days I'm going to walk. But I don't have to be weary. I don't have to faint. Yeah, many afflictions are going to come. I'm going to deal with a whole lot of afflictions. But the Lord is going to come through. I'm going to wait on him because I know he's going to come through. He's going to come through. And when he comes, he is going to deliver me out of them all. There's not an affliction that God can't get you out of. This is what gives you the strength you need. This is what gives you the fortitude to go on. Because you know that our God is a deliverer. This is what this chapter is all about. David ended up in a cave because of the conflict he dealt with regarding Saul. And he wrote this chapter while he was in the cave. And not only did he get revelation for himself, but he got revelation for the desperation of the men that joined. And he sung this particular song to them. And you don't know when you are desperate for God. God, I don't care how you do it. Any way you do it, I'll be satisfied. You see? So what I'm trying to tell you, that this revelation today has come for your desperation, because some of you are desperate for change, desperate for betterment. It can't be like this too much longer. And if you're listening to me and you're not in a place of righteousness, you're not operating according to the standards of God's character, you're on the wrong side of righteousness, you can be saved today. God wants to save you. He wants to deliver you out of everything that's holding you back from becoming who he wants you to be. Because he doesn't, as long as you're not who he wants you to be, you're acting out of character. And perhaps you see that as protecting you, as protection for some reason, but there's no greater protection than the protection of God as he covers you as you walk in the purpose that he has designed for your life. So if you're listening to me and you want to be saved, type that in the comment box. Type it in the comment box. I want to be saved. This is too much. I can't handle this. It's too much for me, but I know it's not too much for God. And I want a relationship with him. You want to be a part of this ministry? We would love to have you as a part of this ministry. We would love it. You can join right now. Let us know right in that comment box. I want to be a part of the Master's Child Church, and we'll make it happen today. I'm excited. And we all can be tired, but same time, I'm excited. I was speaking to one of the associate pastors yesterday, and it looks like had a few associate pastors called me this week, and it was so much in terms of their reports, the reports they were giving me about the state of the membership and some of the things that those who are part of the membership are going through, and those who are family members of the membership of MCC, it was overwhelming. It was 100% overwhelming. I said, God, when is it going to stop? When is it going to stop? And as I began to seek an answer from God, he sent me right there. He said, son, I'm telling you, I'm up front with you. I'm telling you, I never told you that being a part of the kingdom and as it relates to your relationship with me and being in a state of righteousness, as imperfect as it may be, because the perfect version of righteousness is the righteousness that we have through the Son. Because I never told you it's going to be easy. I never told you that, you know, walking in righteousness would equate to you not going through anything. And that's why in the text, David said many. Many. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. He said, but I also told you that there's not an affliction that you would experience that I can't get you out of. And this is my prayer this morning. As I begin to pray, I'm going to pray for everybody who's going through a lot. I mean, a lot. You're going through a lot. Your health, your family, your finance. I mean, just a lot. And at the same time, you're waiting on God to provide an answer for these things. You're waiting. You're not wavering. You're waiting. And I'm praying that as you're waiting, God would strengthen you. So if you're not flying, you can run. If you're not running, you can walk. But you can keep moving and not allow weariness to impede your progress. I know it's a lot, but our God shall deliver you and me out of them all. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for every listener. God, you know exactly what we are going through. You know it. You know it. And you know that we can't waver, we can't backslide, we can't give up, we can't go nowhere, so we're just waiting. We're waiting on you. That's the standard. That's the standard that we are exuding as we are being flooded by the onslaught of the enemy. He's relentless. He's bringing it. He's bringing it. But we know that his many is no match for mighty. And that's who you are. You are the mighty God. And so God, we may be in a cave of despair, a cave of desperation. We may be in a cave of challenges, whatever it is. But thank you, God, that you have allowed some people to join us and be there for us, intercede on our behalf. And it's in these cave-like experiences that you bring revelation. You bring your word to comfort us, to make us understand that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but you shall deliver us out of them all. And we claim the deliverance that only you can give. And I speak it over the lives and the circumstances of the people who are listening to me on today, that you will come through and you will bring us out. All right. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Thank you, fam. And hopefully you were blessed by the word. And I want to sincerely tell you that we have some church family members who are going through a lot. A lot. And I want you to remember those who have, you know, experienced things, and there's still some lingering challenges that they are experiencing right now. You know, stuff is just not over because time has passed. You know, grief is not brief. Pain is not brief. I mean, people are still trying to get through some of the things that, you know, have occurred throughout this year. And they're still trying. They're still waiting on the Lord. They're not wavering, but they're waiting on the Lord. And you got to remember why they're waiting on the Lord to do this. Then something else happens. I mean, it's just, it feels like it's just too much. And it is. It's too much for us, but it's not too much for God. And so we're believing God for every last one of you, that in the midst of what you're going through, God's going to lift up a standard, the standard of his word, to come through for you. So I want you to pray for Lakita Reed and family, Katrina Nelson, the loss of her grandmother, Kara B. Holland and family, Cleo Alexander, James Drummond, Tyrone Humble, Alexia Austin Love and family, Yolanda Long, Denise Barlow, Selena Joyner, and the loss of her sister. We're praying for you. We're praying for you, Katrina, in terms of your losses. Minister Melissa Winbush, Amika Rowley, and family. It's a lot going on. It is. It's a lot. But David reminded us, though it's many, many cannot defeat mighty. And I pray that God's might will prevail on each one of y'all's behalf. We have a whole lot of people going through it. I can't mention what they're going through and because of the confidentiality, I should say, of my disclosure of things, but they are going through a whole lot. So I want everybody who's listening to me, please keep them in prayer. Please keep them in prayer. They really need your prayers. Let's keep everybody in prayer because we believe that prayer is the answer. All right. Well, that's all I have on today. I'm going to be releasing. I'm going to get with my social media team, get with Antoine today. And I'm going to release some information regarding my son, our son, I should say, and brother, in the context of Camille, Trey. So I want you to stay tuned for that. And I want you to read the caption. And you'll kind of see where we are as a family as it stands right now. But I'm going to release it in a few minutes. And I want you to take a look at it and then respond accordingly. All right? Well, you know what time it is. May the Lord keep you, is my prayer. And you know who we are. Despite what we're going through, we are MCC Strong. God bless you.
Melvin Robinson Jr. and First Lady Cheryl Robinson, thank you for attending the Master's Child Church Cyber Sanctuary. We enjoyed worshiping with you. If this teaching has been a blessing to you, we encourage you to sow a seed with any of these giving options. Givelify, search Master's Child Church, specify your amount, and done. The Cash App, $ Master's Child. Our church website, www.masterschild.org. Or use our mailing address, P.O. Box 7810, Upper Marlboro, Maryland, 20792. And join us this week for our weekly services. 6 a.m. prayer, Monday through Friday, our conference call. Noonday prayer, on Tuesdays, via our conference call. Real Word Wednesday, 7:30 p.m., Facebook Live. Walking in Newness, radio broadcast, 10 a.m., Facebook Live. And Sunday Morning Manna, 11 a.m., Facebook Live. As a reminder, if you have any questions or need prayer during the week, please contact the church office at 301-200-1615. Thank you for joining the Master's Child Church. Love never fails.